the first time we saw these dinosaurs, 93, 25 years ago, mm-hmm. now we're looking at these dinosaurs and they're so realistic.
Yeah.
Was that really important for you this time around as well?
It was. It was actually really important to J.A. Bayona to work with more animatronics, something that he really loves and I love too. And I think the first time, because I, you know, we were moving very quickly and I didn't really have a moment to realize that there are certain limitations on animatronics, and based on the sequences that I was building, there was only going to be so much with the amount of money that we had that where we could actually do it. So we just had the one. We had that sequence where Claire finally realizes that these are living, breathing creatures, and I'm really proud of that moment. But for the second one, we realized, well, let's create sequences that are written knowing that you can build an animatronic for it.
And these things are huge. I saw some of them on the other sound stages.
Did they have the T-Rex in there?
They had the T-Rex in there, which is gigantic, and that thing actually moves.
Yeah, it does.
When you first saw that moving in the flesh, did you feel nine again?
I did, and you know, I bring my kids, and so they get to have that same feeling. On the first movie, I remember my son, who was five at the time, got to actually pick up grass and feed grass to the Apatosaurus, and he would eat it out of its hand. And we made sure to bring him in, you know, while it was alive, so he never just saw it lying there. And it's almost like the Muppets. Like, the minute that they come alive, you believe that they're there.
Oh my God, that is the most amazing little gift to be able to give to your child. Does he talk about that all the time still?
He does, and I you know, both of my kids, I have a daughter who got to be on this set, and they're not jaded about it at all, and they're amazed and thrilled that they get to see these things.
It's cool to see as well. I'd be interested to see how it pans out, but seeing Jeff interact with Chris and Bryce, it's kind of the new and the old coming together.
This is part of the secrets of this film. I mean, you will see what is Jeff Goldblum's involvement in it. It's not a major role, but it's a very significant one. I think Ian Malcolm always has been a reminder of what are the dangers of bringing back these creatures. And I think it's very interesting that Jurassic World Fallen Kingdom is the second chapter of a trilogy. You know, so we are somehow getting the consequences of the disaster of the park, and we're bringing the story into a new different level for the third movie. So we are in the most complicated moment of the story.
Yeah.
And in that sense, it's very interesting, because you have the biggest danger that your characters can face in a story.
What was it like, you know, for you coming in, obviously, to this universe and having Steven Spielberg still on board?
So happy, so blessed to have the chance of sitting down with Steven, talk about the movie, the story, the shots I was going to do on set, and having his feedback was amazing. His approval, you know, like, he loved the stuff that I was showing him, and that was very special.
I'm so excited to see this one, because I absolutely loved the first one, and I'm a big fan. What are we looking for in this one? Is it about sort of the relationship between the dinosaurs and the humans?
Yeah, I think there's a lot of that. I think it's the relation between the dinosaurs and humans, you know. Most of the Jurassic movies had been about people saving other people from dinosaurs, but this is the first time that we are going to save dinosaurs. And this movies are very exciting, but at the same time, they have these big themes and these moral debates about the relation between man and nature, man and science, you know. And suddenly we have a story that from the very beginning you need to take a decision about what to do with the dinosaurs, because we have a volcano in Isla Nubla about to erupt and it's going to kill all the dinosaurs. From the very beginning, our heroes, they need to take the decision of going to the island and save them.
Obviously the first one was about saving all the people from the dinosaurs, but this one we want to save the dinosaurs, which is the office that
saving
we're in
the dinosaurs
right now.
From the people.
Were you thinking about any things that were happening now when you were writing?
The moral question of the movie, the ethical debate that starts the film is, you know, do we have a responsibility to save these creatures, or do we let nature take its course? There's obviously a correction that's happening, and they're not our responsibility. And I think that now is, you know, it ultimately turns into a movie that, you know, these dinosaurs are being trafficked and they're being used and utilized for other means beyond, you know, being able to live in the wild. And when I see, you know, white rhinoceros is dying, and that we've just changed the laws about, you know, ivory coming over, you know, I mean, they're really difficult, I think, really difficult and sad ideas for kids to hear and get their heads around. And I think that science fiction sometimes has the opportunity to introduce challenging ideas in the context of something that's also entertaining.